The shadow of the dome of pleasure floated midway on the waves, where was heard the mingled measure from the fountain and the caves. It was a miracle of rare device, a sunny pleasure dome with caves of ice. A damsel with a dulcimer in a vision once I saw. It was an Abyssinian maid, and on her dulcimer she played, singing of Mount Abora. Could I revive within me her symphony and song, to such a deep delight 'twould win me that with music loud and long I would build that dome, that sunny dome, those caves of ice. And those who heard should see them there, and all should cry, beware, beware. His flashing eyes, his floating hair. Weave a circle round him thrice, and close your eyes with holy dread. For he on honeydew hath fed, and drunk the milk of paradise. The Leith police dismisseth us. The Leith police dismisseth us. Yabba dabba do. I grew up at a time where music was just, I mean, it was the common language. Radios were going all the time. Everyone, all social events seemed to be accompanied by music. And, you know, the songwriter as an artist came to life at that time. That became a job. I think before, you didn't think about who wrote the song. You didn't worry about who wrote it too much.
Dames en heren, ladies and gentlemen, big hand, David Olney and Daniel Seymour, big hand.
When I go on stage, I get really excited and I just try to get real quiet in my mind. You can't force who's going to like what you do. All I can worry about is write the song as good as I can and then get up and sing it. My obligation is to the song.
Right.
When the wheel turn around, your number comes up, you can trade in your pencils and your little tin cup.
To me, if I can sit in front of an audience, it's like sitting on a, they call them seesaws in the States. You know, you're looking for that balance where the audience is, they have to be participants and the experience. And if you can get that where you can look out and know if people are rowing in the same direction as you, it's really an incredible experience.
Every other time I played here, I played standing up, and I couldn't do that tonight because I screwed my back up, and it's kind of interesting how I did it. I mean, you might think, you know, you get old and you throw your back out, you know. Not me. I was walking by a canal, and I saw a little kid fall into the canal. And without thinking, I just dove into the canal. All of a sudden, out of nowhere comes this alligator. And I think maybe, you know, wrestling with the alligator who was about to eat the kid may have done this to my back. It may have just been the shock of seeing an alligator in a canal in the Netherlands. But anyway, I finally subdued the alligator, and it's now in the zoo. Wow, I forgot to... I wonder whatever happened to that kid. Well, I don't know. But anyway, that's how I blew my back out.
You're looking for the little odd thing, the little thing that is kind of mystical in quality, that explains some aspect of the universe. You're always got some part of your mind looking for that thing, and sometimes you see it just in a gesture. And I think that's what artists do. They're always looking for that angle. '92, I think, was the first time I came here. But it took several years to kind of get some traction. It became kind of a real thing to me when I started working with Joanna, because then it was much more organized. One of the things in the States it's hard to overcome is they go, I've never heard of you. How could you possibly be any good if I haven't heard of you? Where in the Netherlands, they sit down and listen to what you've got to offer, and if they like it, they like it. And if they don't, they don't. And I've been lucky enough that enough people in the Netherlands have, you know, liked the music so I can come back. In Holland, I remember looking out a place, it was a bar that had a stage, and seeing all these like brown colors and these Dutch faces, and I went, it was like I was looking at a Rembrandt painting. You know, that what you hear about the Netherlands, about Amsterdam, before you come over here is, wow, you can get marijuana. And you think, wow, that's got to be a bunch of crazy people, you know, stoned. But the reason that you can do that in Holland is because people aren't crazy. They have this heightened sense of being normal. But within their normal world, well, there's people like Rembrandt, painters like, you know, Van Gogh, Vermeer. I mean, that idea is there, that there's great beauty in day-to-day things, in the normal mindset of a Dutch person, it seems to me. And I would like to, you know, I would like to be able to take that from the Dutch experience. I was on a tour in The Hague, and I went down to the Moritz House, and I started to get a little worried, you know, that I'm gonna not understand the paintings I'm looking at. I never studied painting. The painting's there. It either hits me or it doesn't. That thing of how do you take in a painting when you don't really have that vocabulary to know why this painting works or why those colors work. You're just taking it in a holistic way. I found where the girl with the pearl earring was, and it was a very welcoming kind of picture. And I just stared at it for a long time and thought, okay, I understand why people care about this picture. Anyway, I got the refrigerator magnet. I sat down and put the magnet there and got the pad and the pen and the guitar and just started working on this song. The way she's just looking directly at you. She had to be looking right at Vermeer, and he's trying to catch this. And you know, they're in like different classes, but at that moment when he's painting, I mean, they're total equals. You know, that it, right at that moment, it's a perfect balance. But I only see that after I've written the song. It's not something you try to, you don't think of that beforehand. You just write something down and then you finish the song and then go, oh yeah. That was really an experience to write that song.
And I could rule the world if that look were meant for me. But oh, she asks too much. For God's sakes, I'm no saint. Before she kills me with her innocence, I'll capture her with paint when she says, I will go where you will lead me. I will follow anywhere. I'll be here if you should need me. Mr. Vermeer.
Kind of breakthrough for me was when I realized that I wasn't particularly interested in myself as a thing to write about. You could easily transform, I think, a lot of the songs into little plays, but that involved pretending I was somebody else or just imagining other people. And that was much more interesting than talking about what I thought about things. You know, I'm not really comfortable displaying my dirty laundry to the world. But if it's somebody I made up, then I can do it with them. But I made them up, so in fact, it's kind of my dirty laundry by proxy.
David Olney was een van de eerste artiesten waarmee ik samenwerkte. En het is een geweldige samenwerking die eigenlijk al 20 jaar lang duurt bijna. En het is... Nou, weet ik veel hoeveel cd's en hoeveel optredens en hoeveel tours. En het is altijd even geweldig en even spannend. En plus er zijn twee geweldige nieuwe cd's uitgekomen in de laatste 2 jaar. Dus jullie gaan heel erg hard genieten van David Olney en Daan Seymour.
James Robinson must turn right or else there's gonna be trouble. James Robinson must turn right to find his way back home. Anne Hutchison must turn left to keep this old world spinning. Anne Hutchison must turn left to find her way back home. Why won't that woman ever do one thing that ain't contrary? Why won't that woman ever see she's turning me inside out? James Robinson must turn right or else there's gonna be trouble. James Robinson must turn.
This trip has been hard physically. You know, I threw my back out and then my voice has been going out. And so I haven't been able to walk around and go out and look at things like I normally do. But, you know, it's always good to get back home. Yeah. There's kind of a equilibrium that you hit. After I've been home for a while, I just start becoming grumpy and I want to get back out on the road. I would be a different person if I just stayed at home all the time. I worry about what I'm going to do. Sooner or later, it just gets to be too much of a physical drain to go out on the road. And I don't know what I'm going to do at that point. It's become such a part of me.
When my youth is gone, in my eyes, you shall remain a beauty. When my youth is gone, in my ears I'll hear you singing sweetly, the sweetest song. When my youth is gone, and when my body dies, darling, I could never leave you lonely. My spirit shall arise, comfort and to care for you only, to sympathize when my body dies. When my youth is gone, should my mind grow dim, should my mind grow weak, if my eyes go blind,
for years, right before I went on stage, I went, I'm unworthy of this. I'm not good enough to be doing this. And then I, you know, over the years I've gone, maybe I am good enough to do this. Maybe it is, yes, it's what I'm supposed to do. And I get somewhat grateful to be able to do this. It's incredibly lucky. Who gets to do that? You make up something in your imagination, and it allows you to cross an ocean and meet people that you never would have met otherwise. Yeah, it's just very fortunate. That's how I feel. And touring in the Netherlands is like visiting close friends to me.
see Sergio do that stuff?
When I go on stage, I rule. I'm a benign ruler, but I rule. That's why they're paying me money, you know, that I can go on there and say, this is where we're gonna go. And I really, really love, you know, 50 people out there. You can see every single one of them. You can make eye contact with every one of them. And, you know, it's really intense in a really good way.
A storm is tearing up the coast, a mighty hurricane. Whoever rules the elements has surely gone insane. And the forecast is for more than the usual fire and rain. It's your choice, you can burn or drown, or pack your bags and head for a border.